G'day, I'm Glenn Morris from the Smart Energy Lab. In today's micro lesson, we're looking at DC arc flash. Now, AC arc flash has been around, well, so has DC, but AC arc flash has been understood in terms of its risk factors and mitigation for a long time. But DC arc flash, the first time in a standard we've addressed it, and that's in the new battery standard, published way back in October 2019. It came into force 3 months later. That's AS NZS 5139. I just refer to it as the new battery standard because actually it replaces the old 4086, AS 4086, and in terms of where it's applicable, it covers all battery systems, whether on-grid, off-grid, connected to an appliance. So it's a battery standard. It's got nothing to do with where it's connected to in terms of grid or not. It's called AS NZS 5139, and I'll just refer to it as the new battery standard going forward. So arc flash, what's it all about? Well, I've got some slides here. I'm just looking at the phenomena of arc flash. It's amazing how hot it can be, up to four times the temperature of the sun. So something like, 19,000 degrees Celsius. It can do a lot of damage. Also, it can travel greater than the speed of sound. Therefore, it can break your eardrums due to the high velocity of the pressure wave that was released from an arc flash. And it will often consume some of the materials that it's arcing on, such as copper cables, etc. And some of that material will flow outwards as a plasma, which is actually the fourth state of matter. So you've got solid, liquid, gas, plasma. And plasma conducts electricity. So in a DC circuit, that plasma will continue to conduct as it moves away for some distance from the surface. That's why arc flash is so dangerous. Anyway, the battery standard actually requires you to do a risk assessment, including calculating what the arc flash potential is and what the arc flash boundary is. That's the zone within which you are possibly exposed to a hazardous arc flash. So what's the threshold? Well, the threshold really is a burn, basically a second degree burn to your skin is considered the threshold. And that occurs something like 1.2 cal, basically holding your hand over a candle for about a centimeter or so, 2 centimeters away for a second. That'll give you a second degree burn. And beyond that, you definitely have to, well, from that onwards, you have to have protection in terms of PPE from arc flash. So, let's look at the formula. Now, the formula is a bit daunting. As you can see, it's got a lot of factors in it. But let's run through what those inputs are when calculating arc flash. The key one is what the system voltage is, what the battery system voltage is. Now, we're talking nominal battery system voltage. So don't assume that a lithium-ion battery, people might refer to it as a 48-volt battery, but you check with the manufacturer, and if it's lithium ferrophosphate, for instance, it's probably around 51.2 volts nominal. So make sure you've got the right nominal voltage. You need to know what the bolted fault current is. Now, this is a tricky one because it's a kind of a new requirement in terms of the battery standard. This is not the breaker rating, if there is one, or the fuse rating, if there is one, built into the equipment. It's actually the maximum fault current before protection kicks in. And so the test for the definition of a bolted fault current is replacing any overcurrent protection device with a 0-ohm resistor. That's called a spanner across the terminals, basically. And what will the peak of that current be? Now, you're not expected to measure this or guess it. This is something that a manufacturer needs to provide to you. So when the standard was first published, it was quite difficult to get this information because many manufacturers didn't have it on their data sheets. But once they went back to their engineers, they could often calculate it from some of the internal resistance of the battery and or any internal overcurrent protection device with a time current series that they could use to calculate the bolted fault current. So you need to find out what that is. Because the bolted fault current, half of that is deemed to be the arcing current. So the arcing current in amperes is what we need to know, and we find that out by dividing the bolted fault current by 2. That's pretty simple so far. We need to know what the working distance is, and the standard says that we use 45 centimeters. Basically, arm's reach is the working distance. So we've all got 45 centimeter long arms somehow, magic. We need to know what the arcing time is in seconds. Now, this is actually a really critical number in terms of reducing the arc flash incident energy. Now, if you don't have any string over current protection device within the battery system, then you have to use an arcing time of 2 seconds. Now, this would be typical of, say, a lead acid battery. It's got no internal overcurrent protection. You've just got terminals that you're connecting your intercell connectors with, and the short circuit current will be up to 2 seconds that arc can form for. And so that's what that default setting is. The arcing time of 2 seconds if no interstring overcurrent protection. But if you have interstring overcurrent protection, you can use 0.1 of a second as the arcing time. So that's 20 times less. Therefore, it's going to reduce the incident energy by 20 times. That's a huge reduction. Or you can calculate it from the time current series of that overcurrent protection device, typically a fuse within a string of cells. So it really helps to have interstring overcurrent protection in reducing arc flash incident energy. Now, I've got a spreadsheet here, and I'll share it with you. It's basically just putting the formulas from the standard into a spreadsheet. And in the spreadsheet, we look at those factors. In fact, you should be able to change only the variables, such as the battery system voltage, the bolted fault current, the arcing time, and something called the multiplying factor. Now, the multiplying factor is basically a phenomena that occurs when you enclose an arc within a confined space. It multiplies the intensity of that arc. So in open air, not enclosed in a room, your multiplying factor is 1. If you're in a room, the multiplying factor is 1.5. And if you've got it within an enclosure, so you open the doors to a battery system, the multiplying factor is 3. So it's really important to get that one right. So we're going to plug in. So we're going to take a 120 volt nominal battery system. So let's call it a lead acid, a sealed lead acid system, 120 volts. Now the bolted fault current for most lead acid batteries is actually provided by the manufacturer already. It's a short circuit current. So let's say we've got some big cells here. We've got some 1000 amp hour cells, and they have a fault current of 11,000 amps. That's for real. And that can be just across a 2-volt cell. It doesn't have to be across the whole battery bank, but yep, 11,000 amps for one string. And we're going to assume that there is no interstring overcurrent protection, as is pretty common in a battery system. And we're going to give a nominal voltage of 120 volts. So it's a fairly powerful battery system, 62-volt cells in series. The multiplying factor, we're putting it into a battery box and for protection from the batteries, from unauthorized access. So our multiplying factor is 3. Now that gives us an estimated DC arc flash energy at maximum power of 19.6 cals per square centimeter. Now that is insane. You can't even go over 4 in a residence. So in a domestic installation, you can't go beyond 4 unless it's in a dedicated building or enclosure that's not attached to a building containing habitable rooms. So we've got a problem here. This nominal 120 volt battery system, 1000 amp hour lead acid sealed cells, can't even be attached to a building containing habitable rooms. Can't be in the garage, for instance, if that's attached. But let's try changing something. Let's put in a midpoint string overcurrent protection fuse. Now, often this is a useful thing to have for the reasons of working at a lower voltage. You'd often split a 120 volt string into 2 60-volt strings at a midpoint, often on the return path if you've got 2 rows of batteries. So we'll put a fuse in there. Now, because we've got a string overcurrent protection device, that drops our arcing time to 0.1 of a second. So let's see what happens when we drop from 2 seconds arcing time to 0.1. So we go from basically it can't be inside a building because it's over 4 cal, a building containing habitable rooms, and we've put in 0.1 as our arcing time, and that drops our arc flash incident energy to 1 cal per square centimeter, which is deemed to be insignificant. It's not even a second degree burn just by putting that $20 HRC fuse at the midpoint. Now, it can be quite a large fuse as long as it's rated for the cable that it's connected to. Hopefully, with discrimination, it would not pop before the main battery isolation and overcurrent protection device kicked in. But yeah, so think about discrimination with that fuse. It should be slightly higher rated than your main output overcurrent protection device. But having it there means that your arcing time drops to 0.1 of a second. So that's a huge benefit. Now, just to kind of illustrate how we might do this, we're going to draw a top-down view of a string of lead acid 2-volt cells. There's one string, there's another string, so we've got 12 in each, plus and minus terminals. Okay. And so this is our output, and our output is going to have a fuse in it. I'm not drawing any isolation here. So let's say we've got a 160 amp fuse at that point there. So in the midpoint, we might put a HRC fuse. So let's say we put a 200 amp HRC fuse. And therefore, we've now got interstring overcurrent protection. We've also got a point where we can break that 120 volt, so it's approximately 120 volt nominal battery system. We've got a point where we can break it for the purpose of working safely at lower string voltages. We'd be working on 60 volt strings as opposed to 120 volt. I mean, best practice is you don't put that return path in, whether it's a fuse or just a linking cable, until you've completed all of your terminations here at the at your output terminals of your battery system. That way you're not working live when you're tightening up some bolts. You should be using insulated tools, of course, but you don't want to be exposed to 120 volts, 11,000 amps in any way possible. Anyway, so that's arc flash incident energy. You also need to calculate the arc flash boundary. Now, the arc flash boundary is the distance within which you need to have the appropriate PPE. So if you're over 1.2 cal per square centimeter, PPE requirements kick in. Now, these vary depending on that cal level. Because we're, in this case, less than one, or one or less than, then we don't need anything. So probably just usual safety precautions, safety glasses, for instance. But once you get up to, up to the 4 cal zone, so from 1.2 to 4 cal, you're going to need things like an arc rated long sleeve shirt, arc rated pants and overalls, a shield with a hard hat, safety glasses, hearing protection, gloves, leather work shoes. There is a whole list of extra requirements as you go up into those higher levels of arc flash. Also, you need to provide a signage to say that PPE is required at the site, and it should list what the PPE is in the user documentation. So there you go. In this little mini lesson on arc flash for ASNZS 5139. Just a reminder for those in New Zealand, even though ASNZS 5139, it's a joint standard with New Zealand, isn't yet referenced in the New Zealand electricity regulations, it still provides best practice guidance for installing a battery system. And I would advise following it just to make sure you're doing your very best when installing battery storage systems. Thanks a lot for watching.